Dell has just updated their XPS 13 laptop, so we figured we'd compare it to a closely priced MacBook Pro. But unfortunately, for the second year in a row, Apple has left the lower end 13-inch model completely untouched, still packing an old dual-core processor. And this is really disappointing since the XPS packs a quad-core processor and the MacBook Pro is quite a bit more expensive for a similarly spec'd model. So we know that the Dell is going to be a faster machine for a cheaper price, but what if the MacBook Pro will still give you a better overall experience despite those downsides? So much so that it'll actually be worth spending the extra cash on it. For instance, the biggest factor in making this decision is whether you like Windows or macOS better. Some people can't stand Windows, so they'll gladly pay the extra cash for a Mac, but for those who don't really mind either one, let's get started. Last year's XPS 13 featured Windows Hello, which automatically logged you into your laptop by using cameras to recognize your face. It was great, but it required the cameras to sit below the display. Well, this year, that feature is gone, so the webcam goes back up above the display without affecting the top bezel much at all. The MacBook Pro clearly has larger bezels that we wish Apple would slim down already, but it still looks okay overall. Technically, both displays are 13.3 inches large, but it turns out that the MacBook Pro's display actually has around 4 square inches more screen space due to using a 16:10 aspect ratio instead of 16:9, which is great for watching full screen 16:9 videos, but the downside is that you don't get as much vertical space while browsing the web, which is a huge positive for the MacBook. Not only that, but the MacBook Pro gets a 2.5K resolution display compared to this XPS, which is packing 1080p, and the difference is easily noticeable. The XPS also has a 4K version, but it's a few hundred dollars more expensive and more comparable to the Touch Bar MacBook Pro. We also tested screen brightness, and the MacBook Pro definitely gets a lot brighter, which is really nice for using in bright rooms or outside, and it's also much more color accurate, with P3 wide color gamut support. As for the design itself, the MacBook's shell is machined out of a solid block of aluminum, so it feels great. The XPS, on the other hand, uses a lot of plastic sandwiched between an aluminum case, so it's also quite a bit thicker than the MacBook Pro at its thickest point, but slightly thinner at the thinnest point. And when you stack them on top of each other, it's also quite a bit smaller. For ports, the XPS features 3 Gen 2 USB-C ports, with 2 of them supporting Thunderbolt 3, alongside a headphone jack and a mini SD card slot. The MacBook is limited to just 2 Thunderbolt 3 ports and a headphone jack, so the XPS wins there. They both use USB-C for charging, but the XPS's charging cable is built into the power brick, so you can't disconnect it and use it for data transfer like you can on the MacBook Pro. Just like last year, the XPS is a bit tough to open up since it lacks a notch in the front, and the hinge has a lot of resistance, while the MacBook Pro easily opens up with just one finger. The XPS's power button doubles as a fingerprint reader so you can conveniently log in without typing in the password like you have to do on the MacBook. And the keyboard feels pretty great with a lot of key travel. The MacBook Pro's keys are very clicky, which I personally prefer, but it's definitely not as comfortable to type on with its low key travel. And perhaps the biggest downside for the MacBook is that it's using the failure-prone butterfly keyboard that's been causing Apple a lot of issues in recent years. Now for the trackpads, the MacBook Pro has the best trackpad out of any laptop ever, and I'm not exaggerating. It doesn't actually move or click, it uses force touch technology to simulate clicks using haptic feedback, so it's extremely reliable and you get an even clicking feel all around, and you can even customize the force it takes to register a click in the settings. The XPS's trackpad is much smaller so you don't get as much room to move around, and it requires a lot more pressure to click the higher you get on the trackpad. However, it's pretty decent compared to other Windows laptops. For the webcams, both don't look very great at all, with the MacBook having a lot of visible noise, which the XPS gets rid of using some heavy noise reduction, but it also adds quite a lot of saturation, making skin look a bit orange. This is a microphone quality test on the MacBook Pro.
This is a microphone quality test on the Dell XPS 13.
But as you just heard in that clip, the microphone quality on the Dell is horrible compared to the MacBook. And before we get into performance, let's compare the speaker quality. I still hear. As you've just heard, the MacBook Pro blows the XPS's speakers out of the water. There really is no comparison in everything from volume to dynamic range and just overall sound quality in general. So far, the MacBook Pro is looking like the champ in overall user experience. From the design, build quality, trackpad, speakers and display quality, even despite the subpar keyboard. However, the XPS packs a quad-core processor, while the MacBook only gets two cores. So let's get into performance, starting with Geekbench 4's multi-core test. For some reason, the Dell is scoring barely any faster than the MacBook, which isn't right at all. It turns out that you have to click the battery icon in the system tray and switch the battery saving slider to best performance. And you also have to plug in the power cable to unlock the rest of the power. Now we're getting a much higher score that completely destroys the MacBook Pro, but we're also going to see less battery life than what Dell rates it at. We saw similar results in the more realistic Cinebench R15 benchmark, where we got almost 100 more points by plugging it into power and using best performance mode. But either way, the XPS outperforms the MacBook Pro by a massive margin. And in Geekbench 4's graphics test, the XPS is once again scoring better than the MacBook Pro, so we're really impressed with its performance. But on a positive note, the MacBook Pro's SSD storage is quite a bit faster than the Dell's, which is useful for everything from transferring data to opening apps. But the Dell is the clear winner in overall performance, so if you're using professional apps that can use all that power, you should definitely choose the Dell. But if you just need a laptop to do basic things like browse the internet, use web-based apps and basic stuff like that, the MacBook Pro will be more than powerful enough. But then again, if you're not using professional apps, you really don't need the MacBook Pro. The better option is the 2018 MacBook Air. It's got newer technology with the T2 chip, fingerprint reader, a more comfortable keyboard, better battery life, and a better price. So in this case, who is the 2017 MacBook Pro for? Well, it's for those who are using professional apps that are exclusive to macOS. But even in this case, I would seriously recommend just paying $1,800 for the 2019 MacBook Pro, which just came out last month and has a quad-core processor. This video is sponsored by PDFelement 7, which allows you to create, edit, convert, and much more on both Windows and Mac. PDFelement 7 has a very simple, Word-like interface so anyone can easily use it, but it's packed with powerful features like commenting, watermarking, batch processing, securing, and more. It can even transform image-based PDFs into selectable, searchable, and editable text. It's a great alternative to Adobe Acrobat at a much lower price. And if you use our link in the video description, you can get 50% off the normal price, so check it out today. If you need help choosing a laptop for your needs, leave a comment below and we'll help you out. If you like this comparison, tap the like button and click the circle above to subscribe. Thanks for watching and we'll see you in the next video.